Opinions expressed on the Jay Thomas Show are the opinions of the host, participating callers, listener emails, and or letters, and are not necessarily the opinions of WDAY or Forum Communications. WDAY 970 AM and 93.1 FM invite you to make your opinion known. We pride ourselves on exploring all viewpoints on any topic.
Do you know who I am? I don't know how to put this, but kind of a big deal. Yeah. People know me.
I'm very happy for you.
All right, let's get it rolling. Jay Thomas Show, good afternoon. Welcome to the program for your Monday afternoon. As always, we'll get one topic out. We hope you respond.
No kidding.
A plethora of topics that I'll try to get to. Hope everybody had a good weekend. Ronnie, how was your weekend, buddy?
Really good.
Yeah.
Really good.
What'd you get accomplished other than partying Saturday night with us at the Fargo Force hockey game? We had a good time, man.
Clean the house.
Really?
It needed to be done. You know, of all of the areas, I am probably the worst at cleaning the home restroom, and really? I had to break down and finally do that. So
the home restroom.
Yeah, the bathroom.
There you go. Man up. The Biffy. Had to clean the Biffy.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah.
Hey, that screen, by the way, is still blue. There's nothing up on it.
I know.
Oh, you know.
I've
got to do some magic on the keyboard?
I do.
Hey, yes. Porta. How you doing, pal?
I'm doing all right.
Rob, there he is. Okay. Rob.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay, there you go. How you doing, buddy? How's
I'm
your
doing
weekend?
Good.
How's the weekend?
It was good. It was really good. It was warm. I mean, it felt like I was having a heat wave.
Gorgeous out right now. I don't know what you guys have a temp there, but I think we're close to 60 here in Fargo.
It's almost 50 here, yeah.
No, it's
I was just sitting in my office. I heard the roof of my house like do a big groan. Like,
isn't that the worst?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's pretty. My house, like, there's the rafters are open, you know, so there's no attic or anything.
Okay.
So
you've got a cathedral ceilings then.
You hear a lot. Yeah, it's a very unusual house. It's and when it rains, it sounds like you're in a tent. I love the house, and it's great and everything, but yeah, no, you could tell when we get big temperature swings because the house starts to creak and groan a little bit, and I was just sitting here thinking, boy, it must really be warm out there because the house is creaking today.
Well, our same thing. You'll get the walls, you'll be sitting on a couch, all of a sudden you just hear this loud crack, you know, and that's just from everything shifting, the house shifting on front. It will scare the living daylights out of you.
Yeah.
40 right now, Fargo Moorhead. That's where we're at. So you're close to 50 out there?
Yeah, 47 is what my thing is saying right here.
Well, you guys must have like no. Well, we were out there back in January filming, and we spent, I don't know, 3-4 days out there. And a majority of the time, we were in Minot in the Burlington area. I mean, we filmed outside. It was that nice. There was literally not enough snow to make a snowball in your neck of the woods.
Well, we have more since then, but not a lot. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot of it's melted.
Yeah, and I think we got some. We're getting down there. I don't know. I mean, 2 good days in the 50s would get rid of what we have. But I'm hearing from our chief meteorologist Weisagi that we could be getting 2 to 4, and there could be some heavier stuff. Just depends on where the bands line up. Hey, folks, quick heads up, and I know our WDAY newsroom is on it. Shooting last night. I think everybody heard shooting. Outside a bar last night, downtown Fargo, 3 people shot. That's all we know. I think it happened just after 12:30 behind the Bismarck. Fargo Police Department will hold a press briefing today at about 3:30 in regards to that shooting that occurred yesterday. So there you go. I tell you, Fargo, man, Rob, I don't know about Minot, but, man, it seems like every time we turn around, there's a shooting now in the metro area.
Yeah. I haven't looked at the statistics to say, because sometimes you get like a rash of them. I remember several years ago there was we had a report that crime in Minot had skyrocketed by like some ridiculous percentage amount, And it turned out it was a group of teenagers that had gone on a string of breaking into cars.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. You know, so I don't know. Sometimes you hear a bunch of stuff, and I mean, are the rates actually up or down? Of course, anytime you hear of a shooting, you know, violent crime like that, it's concerning.
Here in Fargo, Moorhead, West Fargo, the metro area here, it's I gotta believe the cases when it comes to shootings up, because these, and I know what you say, yeah, just like, hey, there's a rash of break-ins. And then you find out once they catch the perpetrator or perpetrators, you know, a bunch of them are all tied together with the same people hitting a bunch of places.
Or if you get them all in, yeah. or the news media maybe covers them all because they happened and there wasn't a lot of other news going on. Or so I don't know. Sometimes our perception of this stuff doesn't necessarily match up with statistical reality. Yeah. Although, of course, that being said, it's troubling that any's happening.
Yeah. All right. Couple things. I don't want to get deep into it because we spent. I'm going to be honest with you. I brought it up Friday, Rob. House Bill 1420, recreational use marijuana in North Dakota. I had David Owens on, and I brought it up. I said, look, I just don't think that this is really a hot topic anymore because it's been battled out for so long, and it's, you know, eventually, you know, whether you like it or not, we're going to see recreational use marijuana in the state of North Dakota. And holy smokes, I was wrong. It was over 2 hours. We couldn't keep up with the calls. Yeah. I just didn't really realize that it was still that hot of a topic for people either for it or against it. We had great conversation. You think this is going to happen this time around, Rob? I do. I think it's going to happen. I think the lawmakers are setting it up for a pass.
I think well, at the very least, I think what we're probably going to see is more decriminalization, because there were two bills. Essentially, one is legalization and the other is decriminalization. I think at the very least, we're going to see, you know, go further down the path towards decriminalization. I think we should go full on. The thing I don't like about decriminalization is because essentially the legislature is saying, well, we don't want it to be a crime anymore. Except it still kind of is. Like, we're just we're going to fine you, and we're not going to keep the. Listen, if we're to the point.
Yeah, we're going to turn our head a little bit, but not all the way.
Right. Either legalize it or leave it alone. Like one or the other. I shouldn't say that. I guess if we're going to decriminalize it, I guess that's better than nothing. But at this point, just legalize it already. And not least because people are just, they're doing it everywhere. It's happening. It's everywhere. You could buy pot in every community. I've been making this argument for years.
It's so vibe.
It is everywhere. We're not stopping it. We're not accomplishing anything with it. Take those resources that we're currently focused on prohibiting marijuana, legalize it, tax it, let reputable people sell it so that the people buying it aren't, you know, finding out it's mixed with something else or something weird like that. It could be regulated so that you know the dosage amount, so that when you're using it, you know, you understand what you're taking and you're not getting surprised there. It's going to be safer for people. And then focus those resources on other drugs.
Yeah, I'm with you. I think the fact that, you know, you got Montana, you got Canada, you know, Minnesota's going to go down this road. South Dakota, I believe there's a fight right now in the courts down there. Point is, we're being surrounded by states that are going to legalize it at this point. Chet Pollard? Is he the majority?
Chet Pollard, yeah.
Pollard, yeah.
Republican from Carrington.
Yeah, even he's saying now that, look, I'm not a marijuana user. I'm not keen on it, but you know what? I get it. It's time we need to look at this. So I really think it's going to happen.
It's funny because Jason Doctor, who is the prime sponsor of the legalization bill,
mm-hmm.
has said that his preference would be that we not legalize it. But also he says, well, I see which way the political winds are blowing. If we're going to legalize it, you know, I'd rather do it in an orderly fashion. And I'm sure the legislature is looking at the flipping nightmare that was the medical marijuana, where we did it through a ballot measure. And it was an unholy mess. Well, and then the legislature stepped in to try to fix it, and they got blasted. They got put on blast for stepping in to do what needed to be done to make it workable policy. So I think what they're trying to hope is to avoid it. So, okay, if we're going to legalize it, then let's do it in an orderly fashion. We'll take a step. The legislature will do it. It'll be good written policy. And then if we need to tweak it further from there, we can.
Well, that's part of it. You're right. But I also think the other part of it is, too, that, and it kind of ties into what you're saying, that our lawmakers here, they don't want another measure put out there for the people to vote on, because I think in their minds, they know as time continues to go on, more and more people are going, yeah, you know what, let's do it. So oh, they yeah. don't want something put out
public
there
attitudes
that is
are complete, shifting. Yeah,
that's completely out of control where they can't, you know, control it the way they want to control it.
And they should control it. I mean, yeah. we elect them for that purpose. And if they're feeling the political pressure, if they're feeling the political winds, then that's democracy. That's how it's supposed to work, is they feel the pressure, they try to interpret what the will of the people is, and then they follow that. So if that's what they're doing, good for them. That's exactly what they should be doing.
Hey, real quick here, before I want to move on. Like I said, we spent all Friday afternoon on this, and I know we'll be hitting it again at some point. Is the what do we got? Crossover coming up
crossover,
here.
Crossover, this is the last week before crossover.
Yeah. Just from an emailer just now, and actually I've got the gal on, Danelle Johnson, at 305, and she's one of the gals that is behind this push to lower the insulin prices in North Dakota. A listener wants me to ask you about North Dakota defeating this insulin bill. What bill number was that again?
Oh, boy. I don't remember the bill number off the top of my head. And I don't think that they defeated it. I think that they hog-housed it, basically.
What does that mean, hog? Because they hog-housed also on the on a gambling.
Yeah, it's a slang term that's kind of pretty specific to the. I don't know where it came from. It doesn't make any logical sense. But when you hoghouse a bill, it's where you amend it and end up, you know, replacing the text almost entirely or entirely.
All right.
So my understanding is they gutted the bill that was proposed, and my understanding is the original bill would have capped prices for insulin, and the lawmakers I think had some legitimate concerns about that, where we're going to set a precedent where the state of North Dakota is going to come in and dictate a price on a product. I don't necessarily want to do that. And oh, by the way, that doesn't necessarily change anything. Like, the way that they were going to do it is because I think they were going to cap it at like $25 or something like that, which is great, except where does the rest of the cost go then? Because it's not just going to evaporate. It's not just going to disappear. Somebody's going to pay for it. Well, it's going to get piled on top of your insurance, and then you'll end up paying for it anyway through premiums. Maybe that's a feel-good win, and maybe for a while people feel, oh, well, that's better. But at this point, I don't know. I see my insurance premiums going up every flipping year.
Yeah.
We have enough victories like that, and we lose the war because our insurance premiums keep going through.
I just can't believe I had no idea how much type 1 diabetes insulin is. I cannot believe the prices.
It's ridiculous.
And not just that, but for other prescription drugs. I mean, come on. If you're a family that, you know, you're in that spot where, look, I can't get any help because I make too much money, but I don't make enough to cover it. What the hell do you do?
Yeah.
I mean, no, I'm for the free market. I'm for that. I'm for capitalism.
The thing is, this is crazy. But we don't have a free market. Actually, this came up because there was another bill in this session, and I think it got defeated. But essentially what it would have done is it would have allowed us to purchase. Because everybody's like, well, bring the drugs down from Canada. It's cheaper in Canada. What a lot of people don't understand is America leads the way when it comes to innovating a lot of these new drugs.
Yes, we do.
They get developed here, and even those that get developed by foreign countries, a lot of that development is built on research and work that's done here in the United States. We also manufacture a lot of them. So American drug companies are leading the way. What happens is they sell into these other countries like Canada, like the United Kingdom, that have government-run healthcare programs. And so essentially what they have is they have these boards in these governments. And these boards come in and they say, well, this is what you're allowed to charge for that drug, right? And there's a whole process that you go through. You know, the drug companies make their pitch or whatever. But essentially, there's a board in Canada that decides, you know, what they can charge for drugs. And so what happens is the drug companies that sell into those markets like Canada is they get everything they can in terms of price, and then they make up the difference here in the United States. And it's really a lot of, and it's like that for all of healthcare. I mean, one of the reasons why healthcare prices are the highest in the world in the United States is we are the great pressure relief valve for all the government-run healthcare systems in other parts of the world. Canadians who can't get care in the Canadian system because they can't get it fast enough
or whatever, they
come to the United States. Yeah. People from other countries who want to be able to purchase care right away come to the United States, not just because we have some of the best doctors in the world, but also because you can buy all the healthcare you want here as opposed to some of these other places. Healthcare tourism is a it's it's people essentially escaping those systems when they can't get what they need. And so, I mean, the solution to drug prices is not to try to control prices here in the United States. What we got to do is really some of what the Trump, I mean, I'm not a Trump supporter. I do not like President Trump, but he was absolutely on the right track. His administration was when they started going after some of these other countries on drugs, saying you can't just control the prices of American products that are shipped into your markets, including prescription drugs. So that's the solution, is we've got to stop letting these other countries prop up their government healthcare systems on the back of the American system.
All right, 293-9000, toll-free, 1-888-970-9329. My email, it's talk@wday.com. That comes in through Tyler's Tree Service, our email inbox here at the studio. More with Rob Ford. If you want to jump into the conversation, you are always more than welcome to. 293-9000, toll-free, 1-888-970-9329. Jay Thomas Show. Emails rolling in regarding this insulin situation. I'll save it for when I have my guest on here at 3:05. Danelle Johnson, her and her family live in a horse, and her daughter, I believe it's Danica, has type 1 diabetes. And when their daughter got the diagnosed with type 1 diabetes, they were in absolute shock when they found out how much this insulin was going to cost, on top of her like umpteen million other medications.
And I want to make clear, I'm not defending the status quo. The status quo is absolutely broken. What I'm saying is I don't want to make it worse. And I'm afraid that this cure that's being pushed is worse than it's not going to fix the problem.
I know you brought it up, but I thought I had heard on the news or read the other day, the former President Trump had done something to help when it comes to the cost of medications in his country, and then disaster of a President Biden with executive order got rid of it.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, Biden, he issued so many. I don't know. It could be one of the things. You know, I know that President Trump, through executive order and some of these trade deals that they were pushing, particularly with places like China, had some language in there that addressed prescription drugs. Now, whether or not, you know, that was what I didn't see that report. So I don't know if that's specifically with President Biden. And I don't know how far down the road Trump did, but I know that they were talking about it. And that is the solution. I mean, prescription drugs are a global market. And the reality is that most of the developed world, unlike the United States, have government-run systems with government price controls. And I'm going to tell you, we had better hope that the United States of America doesn't cave to those price controls, because what's going to happen then is less development of drugs. There's going to be less incentives to put research and development into the sort of drugs that could keep us healthy and keep us pain-free and all the other things that we have come to expect from our medical care professionals. So, you know, the part of the reason that innovation happens here is because there is a good profit. I know profit's a dirty word to a lot of people, but without profit motive, why should anybody invest in these things?
Well, like you have these other countries, like you said, they have price controls, and what happens is, well, we end up eating it over here.
Right. That's exactly what happens.
Yeah, we're only getting this. We're only getting allowed to charge as much over here.
So maybe,
we charge the Americans.
I mean, how it works is you have a drug company, and maybe in Canada they can only make a very slim 5 or 10% profit margin, whereas in the United States, you know, they have to make that up, because again, it could cost them literally billions of dollars to bring a drug all the way to market.
But here's a question I have, and we're honestly, I don't want to move on, but so you know, if you got price control, then and I agree, there's less research and development, because you're not bringing in the money you would have been. But I complain about this all the time when I'm watching TV to Alex or my buddies. Man, the amount of money that is spent by these pharmaceutical companies on advertising.
Yeah.
Asking your doctor for this. I mean, there is a medication for basically everything now. And I'm not talking advertising in the middle of the night. I mean, you watch the national news on the big three at nighttime, even your day-to-day television shows. And I got to tell you, 80% of it is advertising for drugs in drug companies. How much money are they spending on advertising? I mean, my God,
I couldn't tell you, but it's a lot.
You really need to.
Yeah. And I don't know. I mean, I'll tell you, I don't spend a lot of time like taking notes down like, oh, I better ask my doctor about this.
Yeah.
I generally rely on my doctor to tell me, you know, I tell him what's wrong with me and then he tells me if he thinks I need a prescription drug. I guess there's nothing wrong with being aware of what's out there and being able to ask your doctor about it.
But I mean, we're talking about prices. If you're spending billions on advertising.
Yeah.
God, couldn't that? I mean, I might say don't advertise. I get it. But come on, let's be honest. I got to believe a spot on national network news at 6 o'clock or 5:30 at night is not cheap.
I think what they're hoping to do. I mean, a lot of those ads, like if you, I don't know, like if you suffer from acid reflux and you're thinking to yourself,
which I do.
Oh wow, okay. There's a pill that I, if I go in and talk to my doctor, there's a treatment I could maybe get for that. And I don't know. Is that such a bad thing? I mean, I understand people are upset. And listen, I just came through the worst health care nightmare of my life last year. I mean, I almost died.
Yeah.
And I've had to have all sorts. I've been making a lot of trips to the pharmacy because there's been all sorts of drugs and all that I'm still on now. And trust me, it's not pleasant. And the current system is broken. But I don't know. I think sometimes we get distracted with these attacks on big pharma and all this other stuff when the problem with the American healthcare system lays elsewhere.
Mike Audubon, I'll grab you before the bottom of the hour break. Jay Thomas Show.
Yeah, I'll tell you what they did is Trump had a deal where you don't pay any more than $35 for your insulin per month for type 2 diabetes. I know because I got type 2 diabetes. And when Numbhead took over the presidency, he just because Trump had put it into place, he took it off. Yeah. Wow. I've really had it with the Democrat Party.
Even his own party's had it with its own party. I mean, honestly, even the people on the left are going, "What is this guy doing?"
He's following the mandates of the extreme left.
That's exactly what he's doing. You're exactly right. So that's type 2. Didn't he do something with type 1, Mike? It was just type 2 that he did.
I don't know about type 1 because I was type 2. That affected me. And I didn't know. I thought maybe it was for both, but maybe it wasn't.
We'll dig into it. Mike, appreciate the phone call.
Yeah, I pulled it up actually. President Trump. It was July of last year. He issued an executive order to control some. The Biden administration froze it. They didn't necessarily rescind it.
Wow.
They froze it so that the incoming administration could review it. That's their description of it. But essentially that's what's happening.
If it's froze, it's shut down. Was it just for type 2, Rob, or was it for both?
It's actually not just for insulin. It's for a lot of different types, like epinephrine, insulin. Okay.
And that's those EpiPens, right?
Right. Stuff like that. So it's
those skyrocketed.
Yeah. It's when they're purchased through a federal program called 340, it's very complicated. I probably don't want to get into it right now, but
all right. Hey, can you hang? Cause I want to talk to you about this school thing. I have no skin in this game, but you do. You still have kids in school. I want to talk about that when we come back. All these emails that are rolling in at our Tyler's Tree Service inbox, I'll save those for when I have my guest on at 305-293-9000, toll free 1-888-970-9329. It's our weekly chat. We do it every Monday. Find out what's going on in the state of North Dakota. Get up to date with Rob Port, publisher of AscendingBlog.com, columnist, Forum Communications, and, of course, host of the world-famous Plain Talk podcast. More with Mr. Port when we come back to you. Thomas Show. Good timing, huh? Oh, there's Cappy right there. Just when Capel thought he was on a radio, we suck him back in. Pull him back in. You are the man, Cap. Atta boy, Cookie.
Yeah, we'll get this figured out somehow.
Yeah, well, we're just having some technical issues that the listeners really don't care about. Rob Porcetti, blog.com, columnist, Forum Communications, host of Plain Talk.
I'm upset that Rob said hog house because now all I want is a bacon sandwich. So.
Have you been to Smokin' Jay's Barbecue yet? It was at the Moorhead Center Mall. Capel and I went there when they first opened up, and now he's over Tailgaters. I think it used to be Mom's Kitchen. He's in that. Oh, man, I'm telling you, man, that stuff is amazing.
What kind of stuff? Do they have the usual fare, the ribs, brisket?
This guy, every day, he would run out of food. It was that popular.
Oh.
It's like, make more, man. He'd make more. He'd still run out of food.
Okay.
Oh, dude.
Yeah. I got to go there then.
That's good eating right there. All right, we have a bit of a crisis in K through 12 education right now. Those are the words of North Dakota Superintendent Kirsten Baszler. She was on your latest episode, I believe, of Plain Talk. Said her office estimates that as many as 25 to 28% of students currently are not performing at grade level. The chaos of the pandemic has had an impact on the learning of our students, she goes on to say in your interview with her. State lawmakers had charged Baszler with coming up with a list of proposals. Some of the top proposals: high-impact tutoring, social and behavioral interventions, and adjustments to the school calendar. Rob, I have no skin in this game. I have no kids in school. You do.
Yeah.
How are your kids doing?
I could tell you, it's been a rough one. And remember, last year at the end of the year, you know, we did to this distance learning and everything, and my middle schooler did not take to it at all. I mean, she's somebody who needs – kids learn in lots of different ways.
Yep.
She's somebody, though, that needed to be in the classroom.
I heard a lot of parents say that my kids need to be in class, but then there are other parents that said, hey, my kid is flourishing at home.
And if your kid's flourishing at home, that's great, but my kid needed to be in the classroom, yeah. And it was tough for us. This year, I mean, you remember the month of December, my daughter's parents were down for the count. You know, I was in the hospital with COVID. Jess got COVID as well, and she was down for about a week and a half. And then on top of that, you have the mandatory quarantine. You know, if you're in close contact, well, when your parents have COVID, Layla got COVID herself. She's our student, and so you know, between she got it, I got it, her mom got it, and then we had the quarantine stuff where if you're in close contact, you have to quarantine for so many days. She ended up being out of school for like a month. You know, we tried to do makeup work, but with all of us sick at the house, it was tough to keep up with it. So it had a dramatic impact. And I have a feeling that some version of that story is playing out in households across the state.
All right. Let me ask you this. They say in your interview with Kirsten Baszler, the last may be the most provocative in terms of public response, and that is adjustments to the school calendar. But Baszler said in your interview how these proposals are implemented, if they're implemented, would probably look different in each school district. She said it's unlikely that districts would add days to their calendars. Parents and students will likely see some tweaks, such as academic summer camps and weekend tutoring sessions. Here's my question. Now, I'm all about local control.
Sure.
And at the whole start of the Rona, the state of North Carolina, Kirsten Baszler said, look, you know, and I agree, each section, each school district is going to be a little bit different when it comes to COVID and students and cases and all that.
Because COVID hit each district differently,
exactly.
Too.
But did the state here maybe drop the ball by not just having one uniform way of handling this? And going forward, should it still be the way it is where, okay, school district A, if this is how you're going to handle it, you'll get it done. District B, you do it the way you want to do it. Or are we just going to see the same problems instead of just saying, okay, in the state of North Dakota, we got to get these percentiles up. All right, in North Dakota, this is how we're doing it. I don't care what district you're in.
Yeah, well, I the teachers don't want that.
No,
and,
of course
and,
they don't.
And the school administrators
don't. They don't want the lawmakers mandating.
No, they don't want it. And that was a point that Kirsten made. Because when she was essentially asked by the legislature to put together this report of recommendations, because there's clearly a problem. I mean, when you have like a quarter of our students, roughly, that are not performing at grade level, which is to say if you have a third grader, your third graders, 25% of them aren't doing third grade level coursework. You know, that's a problem. So, you know, the solution, though, is a little harder. And one thing that Kirsten said is that the teachers, they don't want the legislature to mandate. And I don't think that the legislature should. We do very, very well, I think, with local control. And I don't think we want the legislature mandates certain things, right? So the legislature mandates that school districts have to meet a certain number of school days,
school
right?
Days,
you
yeah.
got to have, you got to, they got to be in school a certain number of days a year. Remember, some of that was what got waived. You know, Governor Burgum issued some executive orders last year because of the pandemic, and we had kids at home, and they modified some things with that. So I think it's unlikely, because some of the things on the table are, you know, could we go to, like, year-round schooling to try to catch up?
How would you feel about, year-round school at God, maybe I need to go back to school.
I wouldn't like it, and especially in our part of the world. Like, you only get so many days when the weather's nice.
Kids need a summer off.
Also,
man.
I don't know. I learned a lot going places with my dad in the summer.
Well, that's a good point. That is, you know, your life skills learning. Summer, you know, you
One of the best, I remember when we still lived in Alaska, one summer my dad and I took, it was called the McCarthy Trail. It leads back to an old copper mine in Alaska, but it's this old trail. He and I just took off down it with a couple of rifles and some camping gear and an old truck, and we camped along the road. We hunted for ptarmigan. I mean, we just had a great old time with my dad. I still remember that to this day. It was a big, big part of my childhood. We need to leave room in these children's lives to have moments like that with their families and their parents.
You don't think that you're going to see North Dakota go to year-round school?
I think one thing we need to be very, very careful of is making permanent policy in response to a temporary situation, right? The pandemic's a temporary situation. It has created a real problem in terms of the academic success of our kids. And so I think what we probably need to do is go to, I don't want to call them Band-Aid fixes because that sounds like I'm trivializing them, but we probably need some temporary measures to boost those kids and get them back on track.
Well,
and so, which is why I think some of the superintendents talk, you know, having like an academic summer camp, having some specific tutoring resources available. Well, maybe if my kid came through the school year and wasn't doing so hot, I would send my kid there.
I had a lot of parents before we go to the break here. Rob, I had a lot of parents that would reach out to me and say, Jay, I mean, this is just ridiculous. These kids, you know, they're at home learning and their teacher would just give them some ridiculous assignment that made no sense. You know, here, you know, I'm just making something up here, but basically it's at the same level. Here, here's numbers 1 through 100. Tell us which ones are all even. I mean, just ridiculous stuff. I get it from parents or their kids would be get their assignments and they were just so basic that these kids would also be done within a half hour. It's
that was also a situation where you're asking teachers on the fly to take an in-room curriculum and change it and change it suddenly on a dime into distance education.
I think once you get all these kids back in school, and that's where they need to be, whether the teachers like it or not, these kids need to be back in a classroom.
And by the way, as far as I know, the teachers in North Dakota are 100%. No, I mean, I don't want to say 100%.
No, it's not. I talked to somebody over the weekend. Believe me. It's not at 100%. It's up there, Rob, but it's not 100%. Point is, these kids need to be back in a classroom.
Agree.
This whole fear that, oh, my God, if we put the kids in a classroom, there's going to be all these this huge surge in COVID. That's a bunch of garbage.
Well, even the CDC is coming out saying that's not a risk.
If you get these kids in the classroom, I think on a regular schedule, like it was pre-COVID, you're going to see these numbers go back up. Let me take a break. Emails coming in from parents.
But I don't think we should be against if we make some resources available, maybe for some extra tutoring for the kids that need it. Don't mandate it for all kids, but for the kids that need it. Yeah, let's make some of that stuff available. That's what I would like to see.
If you're a parent out there and you want to weigh in on this, I'm getting emails in studio from parents. North Dakota now trying to figure out, okay, what do we do when it comes to getting these kids up to the grade level they should be performing at? 25 to 28% of students currently are not performing at grade level. This is the chaos. This comes from the chaos of COVID. So as a parent, if you want to weigh in, I'd love to hear from you. Has this had an effect on your child? Did your child flourish at home or in class? Love to hear from you. Parents, 293-9000, toll-free 1-888-970-9329. Emails coming in from the parents, and we'll get to those next. More Rob Port, Jay Thomas Show. Right, 293-9000 is the phone number. I got about another 8 minutes or so, Rob Porter. Usually we just have these things for like a half hour on Mondays, but last few weeks we've gone a whole hour. There's a lot of stuff to talk about. Well, and of course the session is in too, so that makes a difference. All right, before I get to the phone calls here, some emails. Jay, what is so frustrating about the school schedules is this March, our Fargo Public School students get a week off for spring break. They should have taken that off the calendar and made the kids go that week to make up for all the months they missed. We just got sent a survey about the calendar about asking if we want to start up like normal in August and end in May or start in September and end in June. Kids get too many days off, Jay, just my opinion. Yeah, I'm with her on that. I mean, if there's this concern, and there should be a concern, that the as many as 25 to 28% of the students currently are not performing at grade level, and we're trying to figure out what do we do here? Do we do this? Do we do this? Then why are you having this week off in March? I mean,
I think there's a lot of stuff that we could do before we get to the point of having to take over summer vacation. It drives me nuts that we have the teacher convention during the school year.
Yep.
They can't go. They have 3 months in the summer that they could do
go
that
then.
When the schools aren't. Go then.
Or at least move it.
We have a ton
on.
Of early release days. Which I mean, really, the whole day shot, because the way our schools do it, they shorten each class, and so the classes end up being short. I don't know what they're accomplishing with the amount of time they have in some of these classes. So, like, it just it's almost like they may as well not even be in days. So they have these early release days, which are a pain. So I don't get it. I'm in complete agreement. Why are we spending so much time, having so many days off during the school year,
especially this year.
And frankly, I realize that this is a pipe dream, but I think also before we get to the point of taking away school breaks, we ought to take a look at the detrimental impact that sports has on the academic curriculum. Because if we want kids focused on academics, then, maybe some of the sports need to take a pause for a while. For these kids who are missing school days because of basketball or whatever, well, maybe that needs to end.
But hold on here. When you go down the road of sports, I believe most school districts, if you're playing on a team, you have to maintain a certain grade average or you're not going to be on that team. So
it's
I think that's already in place.
It's a bar so low you could trip over.
I'm going to disagree with you, Rob, because my kid played sports on West Fargo and the bar was high.
All right.
It was not low. It was high in West Fargo.
Okay.
Let's see another email. I think we definitely need to address the learning losses our children have endured this year. I think the school year needs to be extended, but I'm sure the teachers will complain about this or anything suggested. When it's pointed out to teachers that they work 9 months out of the year but get a salary as a full-time person, they are the first to squawk that they do year-round work. So this year they can just shift all that full-time work they normally do in the summer and teach your students the summer. And I'm going to disagree with you, emailer, because what people don't realize, this argument that teachers work 9 months out of a year and get a full-time salary is bunk. And I'll tell you why it's bunk. That salary is prorated, okay? That salary is prorated for 12 months of work. It's not they work 9 months but get paid for 12. No, it's 12 months, but you're going to put that 12 months of work, most of it, into 9 months of school.
Yeah, they sign.
That argument doesn't fly with
me. They sign contracts, and during the summer months when you're not teaching regularly or you're not at administration, that contract usually makes for one, maybe two paychecks, and you've got to find additional employment during the summer months. Then when school's back in session, your contract spreads out to get regular.
And teachers are paid horribly anyway, so they need to find another job.
I don't know. I don't think that that's true.
Well, it depends on how long
I don't know
teaching.
Many teachers that are working double jobs because they have to.
If you look at the total
compensation that they get in terms of a guaranteed pension, in terms of 100% medical coverage, it's a pretty good. I mean, there's a reason why a lot of school districts have waiting lists for teachers. Because it's pretty decent pay. I don't think they're overpaid, and I think some of this stuff it's unfair to teachers. I think also some of the stuff we do where teachers are paying out of pocket for school supplies.
That's ridiculous.
I think is bunked. I remember there was a bill last session. State Senator Nicole Poolman, who by the way is a teacher for her day job, she had a bill to try to address that. Well, come on. I say this. Jess is going to be a teacher not that far in the future. So. I have teachers in my family. I see this stuff firsthand, and I'm telling you, they're paid pretty well, but they're certainly not overpaid. So.
Here's another one comes in from our Tyler's Tree Service inbox, talk WDAY.com. They should have at least suspended Common Core math during home learning. Parents do not know Common Core math, so it is nearly impossible to teach them unless we research and learn it on our own. Standard mathematics would have been simple for everyone. I'm so glad that Common Core wasn't around. My kids were in school. Holy smokes, Rob.
You can't
You can't just switch the curriculum.
I mean, they had a hard enough time. I mean, because you think about it, like you make a plan to teach a subject in a classroom where you could see the students face to face, you can do all sorts of things that you can't do over a computer screen, or you can't do just making assignments remotely. So the teachers had a hard enough time trying to spin it on a dime. And then some of the stuff we did, like this hybrid model where they're in school some days and not in schools the other day, I think that was even bad.
That was a nightmare.
We could have done a lot of things better.
Let me grab a couple callers before we get out of here. We're rolling up on 3 o'clock. Oates Castleton, hey, Kent, you're up on a Jay Thomas Show.
Hello, Jay and Rob. Hey. Jay, I hate to kind of disagree with you, but
no,
I don't know.
Please do.
Depends on your definition of a bar. I've got boys in football, wrestling, and baseball in high school currently, and they just need a C average. Now, I don't know if a C average is high for West Fargo or what. But
It was higher now when my boys went to school in West Fargo. Yeah, it was higher than a C average.
We had to maintain a 3.0.
Yeah, a lot of schools do that. But you're saying C out in Castleton. Do your boys maintain above a C? Do they maintain above a C?
Yeah, they have to, but it's pretty easy because teachers look past, sports is, like Rob says, it's way too important, and I don't like it. But teachers look past a couple of grades, I think.
Okay, hey Ken, appreciate the phone call. One more here before we get out of here. Greg, South Fargo, Jay Thomas Show.
Yeah, hey, I'll make it quick. Yeah, I took summer school. Rob was talking about summer school. I took summer school years ago.
I never
Fargo
had to.
School system. And I tell you what, it was 8 to noon, Monday through Friday. It was only like 7 weeks, so it wasn't the whole summer. And we still were able to, we got out at noon. We were still able to go mow lawns, play baseball, work jobs, and we got to meet kids from Oak Grove and South High and Shanley.
Yeah, it sounds like you enjoyed it.
I really enjoyed it, and it was only like 15 kids, so you got great attention.
Thanks, Greg. There's no way in hell I would enjoy summer school. Summer school's out, baby. To what the hell is Cooper? I want to go enjoy my summer.
I think the solution to our current problem is make some of these summer resources, make some of these tutoring resources available for the kids that need them. But I don't think we need, because again, we're talking about 25%. That's a big number, but that also means 75%
are doing
fine.
Right. Yeah.
So let's make some resources available for the kids that need them and leave it at that.
100% should suffer. One more quick email. I got to go. I'm running out of time here. Rob doesn't know what he's talking about. My wife is a teacher and pays for most of her classroom things. Her insurance is garbage, so we do full insurance through my job. She gets paid crap for dealing with crappy students and even worse parents.
Boy, I don't know if she or he is a teacher in the state of North Dakota system. They have fantastic health insurance. So,
Rob, what's up? You got 5 seconds. Next plane talk. Go,
Congressman Kelly Armstrong on about wind power.
Thanks, buddy. Appreciate it. When we come back, insulin prices. We'll do it next year. Top of show.